one. So this episode ended up proving to be so long, I decided to split it up into two parts. So make sure you listen to part one of our Lifetime 2020 preview show. And here is part two with the rest of the 30 movies coming up this season.
Then next we have Feliz Navidad, and that's D-A-D, capitalized.
Is this the one with Slater?
So yes. This has Mario Lopez, Annalyn McCord, and this is November 21st. And when I was talking to Amy Winter, she told me that we were talking about how I just can't believe that Mario Lopez is in a movie with a 14-year-old daughter. Like, how is this happening? But the plot is David Morales, an Arizona high school principal and single dad, has lost the holiday spirit after also losing his wife a few years ago during the Christmas season. Now David will do anything to avoid Christmas, so he moonlights as a delivery driver during the holidays. But this year, David's 14-year-old daughter, Noelle, and his live-in sister, Marissa, are determined to bring the Yuletide spirit back to the family, and with a little luck, and help David find love again via online dating. So when Sophie, a witty musician and customer on David's delivery route, swipes right on him, something magical happens between them. And this is written by a man named Peter Murrieta, and all of his credits were all sitcoms that he had done. So I hope that it'll be kind of funny, that maybe there'll be some energy to it. Mm-hmm. I don't love Annalyn McCord's Hallmark movie. Her Christmas Parade isn't my favorite, but I'm willing to give her another shot. I like Mario Lopez. I think this one sounds pretty good. I'm pretty excited about it. It's set in Arizona, which is madness. I mean, there's never Hallmark Christmas movies in a warm climate like Arizona. But Dory, what do you think?
I'm excited for this one. I'm going to give it an orange. I actually tend to really like these single dad movies a lot. Like,
hot widower.
Yeah, exactly. Like, the widower ready finally to move on. Like, I'm super into those movies, and this description was cute. It's written by a sitcom writer. I think it has all of the components that could make it really fun. I'm with you on Annalyn McCord. She hasn't been my favorite, but I mean, maybe I just need to see her in the right movie. So I think this sounds really cute. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, if you think about it, Twinkle All the Way last year, which was so good, was the widower, hot widower.
Yeah.
And do you agree, Rachel?
I'm going to give this one a diamond. Yes. Because I love Mario Lopez. They're rebooting Saved by the Bell. Yes. I love the idea that they're using, take this Alaskan newspaper revival, that they're using the swipe right thing. Like, they're tuned in.
Right.
And I love the fact that he's living with his sister. Like, that gives a family dynamic. The thing about these single dad movies is that you're automatically on the guy's side because they obviously care a lot for their kid. I love Dear Santa. You guys know that one. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Where he like drives the snowplow. So I think, and the Arizona setting, I thought this one sounded really cute. And did you guys watch Date My Dad? Was that the one with Barry Watson? It was a limited, it didn't get renewed, but I thought that was really cute because he had such a great chemistry with his kids. And so, yeah, I'm down for Slater being in a Hallmark movie. Yeah. Thumbs up.
I think I will also give it a diamond ring. For all those reasons you said. So yeah, if it was someone like Sarah Drew, I would be like, huge diamond ring, because would be like,
oh, they should have put those two together.
It would have been amazing.
My story is that I was in Vienna last year just as they were starting to film Christmas in Vienna with Sarah Drew. So I was like wandering the streets waiting to see if I could see her, and I didn't, but
Made Christmas. This is November 22nd. It stars Michelle Argiris and Travis Nelson. Sorry if I mispronounced your name, Michelle. So this is, we don't know the writer or the director. This is every year Megan, an ambitious young woman, uses the weeks leading up to Christmas to become the ultimate holiday freelance assistant for hire, helping with any Christmas-related task for extra income. But when the opportunity arrives to save a Christmas party and dazzle her crush, she must choose between the man of her aspirations and Mr. Right. So the one thing I do like about this is that they're not trying to pretend that this is some kind of major career for her. Like, right. It's just to earn extras on the side, which I like. Yeah. Because some of these, like Christmas Festival of Ice or the Christmas Made to Order, where it's like, where Alexa Panavega is supposedly going to be doing this for her whole career. And I'm like, it's
such This is hustle. Not a real job.
It's not a real job. So I kind of like that in this description. But other than that, it's pretty basic. And I don't know either of these actors, so I'll probably give it a sock, but it has potential. What do you think, Dory?
I'm just looking up the guy in this. I just want to see them. Okay. So they look kind of younger. And I'm actually going to give this an orange because I like that it's kind of like a nod to the gig economy that we're all in. Yeah, instead of acting like that doesn't exist. Like, I have so many friends who wear multiple hats. Yeah. Hi, Rachel. Who like have a bunch of different gigs that they're doing to make ends meet, whether it's, you know, temping and driving Uber and delivering food for Postmates. Like, that is real, you know, to like need some extra money over the holidays. And so you're an assistant for hire. I really love that. I love when they acknowledge kind of what's going on in the world. It sounds like they'll make it fun and interesting. Or they have the potential to make it fun and interesting. I trust this in the hands of Lifetime more than I would Hallmark, quite frankly. And I'm going to go orange. I think it has potential.
What do you think, Rachel?
I'm going to go orange too. And it's, remember in While You Were Sleeping when she had like a normal job for a romantic comedy heroine. And I loved that. She worked for the L. And I'm with you, especially in the year of COVID where people are having to come up with new ways. And I like seeing real people fall in love. And I'm sorry, ice sculptress, you do not have a 365 day a year ice sculpting job.
Especially one that's going to pay for her expensive legal education that she's just had. Yeah, I don't think that's happening.
Amazing apartments for being like a part-time gingerbread consultant. Like, no, it makes no sense. And so it's time to give a nod to all of us who don't have these magical lives. And so for that, I'm giving it an orange. Solid orange here for that.
Well said.
All right. Very good. Okay. So then we have Dear Christmas, and this is on the 27th of November. This stars Melissa Joan Hart, Jason Priestley, Robin Givens, Ed Begley Jr., Faith Prince, Nikki Whalen, and then a bunch of cameos. It says, with cameos by Jamie and Doug Huener, Hillary Burton, and Antoine Tanner. I think that's our only Hillary Burton sighting this entire holiday season, is this cameo, which I don't know why I shouldn't have said that. I should have spoiled it for you like they did. But this is directed by Emily Moss Wilson, who did Christmas Wish with Hillary Burton. So that probably explains that. Last year, she did Christmas in Louisiana and Christmas in Mississippi. So she has a pretty good track record. And it is written by Juliet and Keith Giglio, who did Christmas Reservations and A Very Nutty Christmas and Return to Halloween Town. So they have a pretty good TV movie repertoire. I didn't like Christmas Reservations, but the rest were pretty good. So here's the plot. Natalie Morgan is the host of a popular podcast. That's always tricky. Holiday Love. I'm always looking at these podcast movies, which shares true stories of holiday romance with its listeners. While to the outside world and her listeners everywhere, Natalie is an expert on romance. She's never truly experienced a romance of her own. As Natalie prepares to embark on a promotional tour for her new book, she stops back home to spend Christmas with her family, where she unexpectedly begins to experience her own holiday romance as sparks ignite with local firefighter Jack. Jason Priestley. So one thing I kind of like about this movie, about this description at least, is that that there's not the old high school boyfriend. This is just somebody who's like never had love. And that's something you never see depicted in anything. And there are people, and I'll be honest, including myself, who have never really had a love, you know, that it's not like they have their high school, you know, romance or whatever to look back on. You know, you've been on dates and you whatever, but you've never really had a love like that. They're kind of like that. And I have a feeling like Melissa Joan Hart and Jason Priestley will have good chemistry. I feel like so I don't know, I feel pretty excited about this. I mean, the writers have written good stuff in the past, the directors directed good stuff in the past, it's got like a huge cast of people, and what do you think, Rachel?
I think I'm gonna give this a diamond ring, partly because I think Melissa Joan Hart and Jason Priestley are gonna have fantastic, I think they'll be very great to watch together. I like the fact that, again, what you said, I think that Lifetime and Hallmark does well at featuring love stories for women who are not 20-somethings. And I really like the fact that someone of Melissa Joan Hart's age can find love for the first time. And the fact that it focuses on more mature people, I think is really great, because, you know, you can find love when you're not 25. Mm-hmm. Or 37 playing 25. and I think that this has a lot going for it. Do I think that maybe they're overshooting by, you know, using people they could have spread out to cast in several of these? Yes, with all these cameos, but I think it looks cute. So diamond ring for me.
What do you think, Dory?
I'm also going to give this a diamond ring. It's just checking a lot of boxes for me. Podcast host, of holiday love stories, you know, goes back home for Christmas, firefighter, never been in love before. I'm into this. This is checking a lot of boxes for me, and I'm looking forward to it. And I also agree with everything you both said, and I agree that I think that these two will have good chemistry, you know. It kind of, like, when you said both of their names, I'm like, huh, why haven't they been in a movie together before? Like, I feel like they should have been together before, so I think this will be a cute one.
All right, so then we have Merry Little Christmas Wedding, this on the 28th, and this is actually Lifetime's first ever sequel, Christmas movie sequel, which I thought was amazing that they've never done one up until now. And this stars Kelly Rowland, Thomas Kudrow, Debbie Morgan, Bresha Webb, Latanya Williams, Jamie Calica, Nathan Vitti. And so everybody from the first movie is back. And this is directed by Sharon Lewis and is written by the same writer of the original, Andrea Stevens, who also did Christmas Jars and Christmas Connection. And so this one is, that's once again follows Jackie Little as she and Tyler try to plan their perfect destination Christmas wedding. Naturally, Jackie's plans go awry when her boisterous family intervenes in her planning and her snooty wedding planner quits in protest. While nothing goes as initially planned, Jackie and Tyler get a Christmas wedding more memorable than they could have ever dreamed. So, Dory, I'll let you go first because I know you love the original.
I did love the original, and this gets a diamond ring from me for that reason. I just really enjoyed seeing, like, an obnoxious, fun, loving Black family on screen for Christmas, and that gets my vote, and it gets my backing every single time. And I love that there's a destination wedding component to this, and a wedding planner that quits. I mean, that just sounds like hilarity to me. So I'm all in on this one.
What do you think, Rachel?
Diamond as well, because I really liked the first one. They all have fantastic chemistry. I like me a good wedding holiday story, and I think it has a lot of potential. And if we're going to do a sequel, let's not make another Christmas in Evergreen or another.
Rachel, you know, you're like speaking my love just, language.
Like, how many again? Like, Christmas in Evergreen number 12. This is a sequel that I can get behind because the dynamic works so well, and because the supporting characters have enough potential for their own stories that it won't just be recycled. So A plus. Good job, Lifetime.
I guess what I didn't like about the original movie is I just felt like her family was super rude. Like, she'd gone to all this effort to have them over to her house for Christmas, and they just did nothing but complain about everything that she did. They weren't open to anything new, even the way that she cooked things, the way that she was doing things. I mean, I just felt like there was all the shenanigans, which were fun, but they were just too much for me. And I just thought, like, come on, she's letting you into her home. The least you could do is, like, try her cookies, or, you know, like, try something. Like, not everything has to matter that much, you know. Like, you pick and choose your battles when you're at a family event. And I don't know, I just really, they really irritated me. And so I didn't like the first one. It wasn't my favorite, but I like all the cast and I'm willing to give it a shot. Wedding movies tend to not be also my favorite. So I'm going to give this a sock, but I hope you all are right and I am wrong. So I certainly applaud the diversity. That I think is great. Okay, then we have, and I don't understand why this one gets the I don't know what you call it, the introduction, the coda thing with People Presents Once Upon a Main Street. I don't, and so this is actually like financed or presented by People Magazine. And the only other time, I guess the only other time they have done that on Lifetime, it was for the Meghan and Harry movie, was People Presents Harry and Meghan, which was terrible.
That opinion, was at least. Awful.
It was terrible. but so I don't know what the heck is up with People Presents Once Upon a Main Street, but whatever.
That was awful.
It was really bad. This is November 29th. And this stars Vanessa Lachey and Ryan McPartland, who I love both of them, and Patrick Duffy. And it's directed by Don Perez, written by Don Perez, who did My Christmas Dream. That was the Danica McKellar one I can't think of the guy's name. Anyway, and then Polly Draper is the director. And here we go. Super long description, so sorry. Amelia Lewis is super excited when she buys an available storefront planning to open a year-round Christmas shop. But her celebration comes to a screeching halt when she discovers that Vic Manning has also bid on the property. Amelia and Vic have the same idea. Get to the seller, Elder Dubois, in the next town and convince him to sell his space to them. Despite the holidays, Elder is down in the dumps. It's the first Christmas without his wife, and he's in no mood to chair the decoration committee for the Battle of the Main Street yearly holiday competition with the neighboring town. Hoping to win favor with Elder, Amelia and Vic volunteer to take over his duties. After continually bickering and trying to one-up each other, the two combatants learn to work together and even get the merchants on Main Street to put aside their differences for the greater good. Everyone, including Amelia and Vic, realize that compromise is the key that leads to a happy and romantic ending. So the one thing about this is that, like, there's not a Main Street in America that's like people are fighting for space. There's space in spades. So I mean, I guess they wouldn't want to have two full-time Christmas shops in this town, so I guess that's more the debate rather than the space. But they are fighting it out to get the attention. I'm sure that people are named Elder, I've heard of that, but I feel like it's sort of an interesting name choice. But yeah, that's a lot. I feel like that was a very convoluted summary going on there, but I love Ryan McPartland. He was into it all the way and he was so good. And I really do like Vanessa Lachey a lot as well. So I don't know. What do you think, Dory?
I have to give this a sock. That description was a wild ride. Yes. And I mean, there's too much happening. Like,
just too much Christmas. Like, too much Christmas. Too much.
Like, I mean, you could have made it a movie just about, like, the two of them trying to get this space, but now they're doing that by, like, becoming, planning going a festival. On the decorating committee. Exactly. They're planning a festival. This is a lot of tropes jammed into 1 hour and a half movie, and my head is already spinning. So sock from me.
You agree, Rachel?
Sock with like a squirt of orange juice, because I do like the two leads, but it's almost like this was written and someone was just like, hey, let's put it at Christmas. So let's shove all the Christmas in it.
Yeah.
Like it could easily have been, it doesn't seem organically Christmas. It seems like something that had been written and then they just decided to put it here. So too much going on. So sock, but squirt of orange juice, because I really do like those two. They're going to be good together.
All right. So then we have the Christmas listing this November 30th, and it stars Lexi Giovanni and Travis Burns. And this one is Julia Rogers is an uptight, hardworking realty owner who has lost her Christmas spirit. She will have to spend 5 days at a Christmas inn with her business competitor, Chad Everest, in order to win over the badly needed listing of the Erickson Farmstead. While competing to win the listing, Julia and Chad discover that they have more in common than they thought. So, Rachel, what do you think?
Chad Everest. Like, could you find a more Christmas movie guy name than Chad Everest? Yeah. I'm going to give this a sock, because a Christmas inn is not a real thing. And this is just, I just feel like it's, yeah, it wasn't working for me. Sorry, yeah. Chad Everest and your Christmas inn.
I'm going to give this a call. I'm sorry. But I just think it sounds so basic and nothing here. And I don't know either of these actors at all. So, and I don't know a writer or director. There's no reason for me to have much hope for this one. I'm sorry. So, yeah. What do you think, Dory?
I'm giving it a call too. The movie right before it is about real estate. I cannot do this twice. What? Yeah. No, I'm sorry. One lump of coal.
How many recession COVID year real estate movies?
Right. How many people right now are fighting for real estate listings? I just, this is,
oh no, not the Christmas Inn. Yeah.
They tried to get us it with the Christmas Inn, but we are professionals here and we could not be fooled. That's not a thing and we know it.
I want to go to the Christmas Inn, socially distanced, of course. All right. I mean, it sounds like the
too nice and can't get
I know. Rachel's like, I cannot do cold.
What was that terrible one that was the Christmas in July about the Christmas Inn? Oh, it was so bad. I can't think of the name. Just triggering it from my mind.
Christmas Camp?
Christmas Camp. No. Yeah, Christmas Camp. Oh, it was so bad. Christmas Camp was like walking their dogs. That was like all that was Christmas Camp. It was so lame.
Camp was bad, but I was so desperate for the feeling of Christmas that I was like, you know what? This will do.
I'd even watch the Hat movie. The Hat movie, I will give
exactly.
Cool to.
Exactly.
That is a terrible movie. The Christmas Hat store, that is not a real place. So no one stupid. Can make money to survive with a Christmas Hat store.
It's so stupid. Like, you really would never have like a year-round Christmas Hat store. Who needs what?
It's just ridiculous.
Yeah.
Okay. So then we have Spotlight on Christmas. This is on December 4th. This stars Tori Anderson, who was in the Christmas at Creek, Christmas at whatever Creek.
whatever Creek.
It was called. It was, she was in, She was in Return to Christmas Creek. I was close. Right. And I hated that movie too. I really disliked it. And then she was also in Love Under the Olive Tree.
Which branch.
Favorite Dory.
As my friend Mel called it, Love Under the Olive Tree Branch, or Meet Me Under the Olive Tree Branch.
Yes. It does have Victor Zinc Jr., who I really like. He's good. He's usually the wrong guy, but here he's playing the lead, so that's cool.
I love it when a wrong guy gets a lead.
I know.
Yeah, that should be a Christmas movie. It should be about an actor who's always the sidekick. That's who finally brilliant. Gets the lead.
That would be
so very much more meta fun than some of these real estate movies.
Rachel, you need to write that as a book.
All right, and then it has to be like it's he moves into the leading role after.
Oh my gosh, you should write that.
Or the wrong guy. Because you know there's like those three actors who always play like the bad fiance who wants to go to the Caribbean instead of the cabin.
Yeah.
So those guys can finally get the cabin and the girl. Yeah.
That was what was so weird about Christmas, the first Christmas in Evergreen. Like the your supposed romantic lead guy, he wants to go to Florida the whole time. Like, what is going on?
That's how you know the Christmas guy is bad.
I'm like, Marcus Rosner, he's supposed to be the bad man of business, but he's literally flying a helicopter all the way to Vancouver just to see her. Or wherever they're at. They're like in Vancouver, and here's her guy that wants to go to Florida. So I'm like, why is he the bad guy and just, this guy's the good guy? It makes no sense.
No, the bad guy is the non-snow guy. We know this. And then we end up not liking the heroine because even though she's adorable, she fell for these terrible guys.
So I've always said that Ashley Williams picked wrong. Like, I want the guy who's willing to fly the helicopter in just to see me.
Yeah.
This is true.
Evergreen 14.
Not the one who's dying to leave.
He gets his own.
Yeah, so she picked wrong. Anyway, so dumped 2 weeks before Christmas, actress Olivia O'Hara secretly returns to her tiny hometown to hide out, eat cookies, and avoid the press. What she doesn't expect is to be faced with the family she left behind, meeting a charming new guy, Casey Rollins, and a noisy reporter following her every move. Completely overwhelmed, Olivia contemplates running away from her life once again, but with a newfound confidence and freedom, Olivia bravely steps up to take the starring role in her own life, realizing that home is where the heart is and that she deserves to be loved for exactly who she really is. So A+ to the summary writer. I think that was very well done. Whether the movie will be good, I don't know. I think that it has maybe a little bit of a feel of Christmas at Homestead.
I was just like so Christmas good. In Homestead with my boyfriend, Michael Rady. Michael Rady doesn't know he's my boyfriend. So there I'm announcing
the secret's out.
Yes.
I don't know. What do you think about this, Rachel?
I think it's a sock because it's too Christmas in Homestead. I do like the fact that she's going back and finding a new guy instead of a high school boyfriend. But the whole reporter thing is kind of tired. There was also that Andrew Walker film where he was a high school teacher and the star showed up in the hometown. It wasn't a Christmas
theme. I like
theme.
That one.
Yeah.
Date My Love or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, it should have been called... It should have been called like the star date or celeb date or something like that. But anyway, what do you think, Dory?
This is a sock for me. What I don't understand is in the description, it says what she doesn't expect is to be faced with the family she left behind, but she's gone home to her hometown. She didn't think she was going to see her family.
Yeah.
Where did they go?
Right. Right. And the family she left behind, did she leave behind a child? Did she leave behind her parents? That is throwing me and I can't stop thinking about it. And it's going to drive me crazy now. Mm-hmm. So I guess clearly I'm going to watch this because I got to see about this family she left behind, but I'm going sock for this. It just doesn't really, you know what? The actress in small town movie either really works for me and I love it. Like, I really liked the Homestead.
Oh, yeah.
I liked that movie really a lot. I thought it was excellent. But there are some where I'm like, I hate this diva. Mm-hmm. I want
Well, that's what's weird about this movie is that she seems so non-diva. Says that she needs to, get her confidence, newfound confidence and freedom, and that she's a starring role in her own life and all this stuff. And like, typically the most of the actresses kind of plot that you see is somebody who's like a little full of herself, like a little, mm-hmm. and then she has to be charmed by small town life.
That's true.
So it's kind of weird. Yeah, why wouldn't you just stay in LA if you wanted to eat cookies and avoid the press? Nobody's doing anything in LA in Christmas.
Well, and why, why, if you are trying to avoid your family, would you go home? Yeah. The last thing I would do if I wanted to avoid my family in Cleveland is go back to Cleveland. Not that I would ever avoid you, my family in Cleveland. You know I love you. I would never be.
Like, you kind of know they're going to be there.
Right. Like, she's going home to hide from the family that she left behind, but she's going to her family's home. What? I don't get it.
I'm
going to
give this a call. I think this sounds pretty terrible, and I have no faith in even these actors, you know, especially I like Victor Zink Jr. I'm sorry.
No faith.
The
no
gold faith. Star to the copywriter who deserves for a raise sure. for yeah. that starring role in her own life.
A plus.
Yeah. plus to you.
Way to go to the
and saying
writer.
She wants to go home to eat cookies and hide from the press.
That kind of like reminds me of in The Holiday, you know, when she goes shopping and like, you're having a party? Not really. Okay, so then we have Let's Meet Again on Christmas Eve, and this stars Kyla Pratt and Brooks Darnell, and it airs on the 5th, and this is directed by Jeff Beasley, who did Holiday Date last year. That was the one with Brittany Bristow, and also did The Christmas Club, which we're fans of here. And this, very exciting, written by Carly Smale, our favorite Christmas pen pals and Snowden Christmas. She's amazing. So here we go. When college sweethearts Karina and Rob get opportunities on opposite sides of the world, they decide to part ways and meet again in 2 years on Christmas Eve to see if they are really meant to be. However, when one shows up and the other doesn't, the fate of their romance seems to have reached the end. Many years later, the two end up bumping into one another when they are both hired to help bring together a Christmas Eve wedding. With many questions left unanswered, they are about to embark on a journey filled with romance and magic just in time for Christmas Eve. So this sounds a lot like An Affair to Remember?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fair to
but
remember.
Sad.
They're supposed to meet on top of the Empire State Building, and then they don't. And because of it's everybody should see that movie. It's really good. And so yeah, and I just this sounds really cute to me. I think it sounds good, and I liked Kyla in the movie, not her last year. I didn't love her movie last year, but then the year before, I really liked her movie. And I can't remember much about it, but I just remember liking it. And then Brooks Darnell, I feel like he's done a couple things before that I've liked. So I'm pretty excited about this. I think it sounds pretty good. Do you agree, Dory?
Oh yeah. I freaking love this concept. This actually is going to get a diamond ring from me. I love the idea that I love how realistic it is. Like, mm-hmm. we are still kids. We are still young. Like, let's go our separate ways, live mm-hmm. our lives, and then try and come back together. And the fact that it doesn't work out one time, but it's going to work out this second time, hopefully. I think that that is so cool. I really mm-hmm. like that concept. It just seems a little different, and I am super into it. I think this sounds really, really good.
It almost has a little bit of Persuasion feel to it. A little bit. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Do you agree, Rachel?
Yeah, I'm going to give a diamond ring because I find that a lot of these movies don't focus on emotionally mature couples, and these two people mm-hmm. seem to know each other really well. I also mm-hmm. like the idea of the buildup for a reunion that doesn't happen. Yes. So then they have to live with the fallout of it. Like, yeah, diamond ring for this. Also, they're both adorable, so mm-hmm. this will be great.
So the problem with her movie last year is I felt like he seemed, even though I don't think he actually was in reality, but he seemed way older than her, which just made it a little bit awkward. And she has such a sweet kind of mm-hmm. younger seeming voice and demeanor. So I think the casting wasn't quite right with her movie last year. But
right.
anyway, so we have Christmas Ever After. This is on December 6th. This stars Ali Stroker and Daniel D. Tomaso. I couldn't find any of the other information on it, but it's popular romance novelist Izzy Simmons spends every Christmas at her favorite snowy bed and breakfast. But this year, she's faced with an impending deadline and a severe case of writer's block. Luckily, inspiration strikes in the unlikely form of the B&B's new owner, Matt, who bears an uncanny resemblance to the handsome hero from Izzy's novels. As both partake in the lodge's annual itinerary of Christmas activities, Izzy's writer's block is cured, and the first pages of her and Matt's own love story may just be beginning. So this is exciting for a lot of people because Ali is in a wheelchair. She's the first one of these kind of Christmas movies to have disabled representation. And so that's really exciting. Plus she's just super cute and Tony winner. And so I think this sounds really cute. I like the fact that she goes to this every year, this inn. It kind of reminds me of the one with Allison Sweeney and Jordan yes. Bridges, mm-hmm, that yeah. one with the Christmas that Inn and everything. That was yeah. cute.
Mm-hmm. Holly Lodge or whatever.
It's yeah, called. Yeah. yeah. That's what yeah. it kind of reminds me of a little bit. There's not really like a bad man of business in this. Like, it's just the owner of the inn and then her like figuring out writing. So I think it sounds really cute. I'm going to give this diamond ring on this one. I think it sounds really good. And I'm excited for the people that are going to be represented for the first time. So yay. What do you think, Dory?
Oh, I mean, I'm counting down the days to this. I mean, this gets a full jewelry store for me. I mean, you know, I think that, and I think we're guilty of this too on our podcast. We talk a lot about diversity, but we a lot of times don't talk about diversity of ability, and that matters too. And, you know, I'm so grateful that Lifetime is doing this movie. I think Ali Stroker is a star. Like, you look at her and she is just a bright, shining, beautiful light. I think that she's going to light up this movie. I'm so excited for this, and I'm so excited for people who use wheelchairs who get to see themselves yeah. in her role. I think yeah. that is beautiful, and I want more of it. And then, like, on a smaller level, I just love a B&B. I love that it brings different people together who might not otherwise, you know, have met ever. It kind of reminds me of in Love You Like Christmas. She stays at a B&B, and there's like a traveling salesman who always stays there around the holidays. And like, it's just, it's a yeah. nice little community that is built.
It kind of reminds me of The Let It Snow, the one with yeah. Candace Cameron Bray. But in that case, that one has a bad man of business. This one doesn't even seem to, which I like.
Yeah, me too. I love that she's a romance novelist. I love that she has writer's block and that this hot guy is going to help get her out of it. I mean, just every note of this sounds like my kind of movie.
Yeah, there's also the Mistletoe Inn. Mm-hmm. That kind of has similar themes, one. Which I really enjoyed. Do you agree, Rachel?
I do. So I wrote this one Christmas book, but I'm a historical romance novelist. That's what I usually do. And I'm always falling in love with my heroes, and yet none of them have come to life. So
not
I think
yet.
That's just
not
adorable.
Yet.
Not yet. I also fell in love with Ali on the Tony Awards when she was up for Oklahoma and she won. And I think, again, it's about time we had everyone should be able to enjoy either loving or mocking these films equally. And so they need to be able to see themselves in them. So yeah. Yes, all across the board, diamonds all around, love everything about it.
Yeah, very good. Okay. Yay. So then we have the Santa Squad, which I love that title. I think that's so funny.
Yeah, that's an awesome title.
This is on December 7th. And this stars Rebecca Dalton and Aaron Ashmore. It's directed by John Bradshaw, who did The Christmas Cure and Merry Matrimony and the Best Christmas Party movies. And written by Mark Valenti, who did The Christmas Pageant way long ago. So here we go. Allie, an out-of-work art teacher, has to accept a job with the Santa Squad to help wealthy widower Gordon and his two precious daughters rediscover the magic of Christmas. As Allie is lifting the holiday spirits of the family with Christmas decorations, cookies, and shopping, her kindness is rewarded with the most unexpected of gifts, love. So what do you think, Rachel? Do you want to join the Santa Squad?
I'm going to give it an orange because it sounds cute, but that's the, you know, it's cute. Nothing hugely different about it, but whatever.
It sounds cute. Kind of like the, I called it the Christmas Batman movie last year with Aaron Cahill and Kevin McGarry. Mm-hmm. I forget what it was called in reality.
Random Acts of Christmas. Yeah,
I liked that one. It was good.
Yeah.
But yeah, you basically had Bruce Wayne for Christmas.
I loved that movie.
Yeah, it was good. I kind of wish it was more of a squad. Then I'd be super excited. I mean, it's basically like the Christmas family. It's not like a squad. And if it was like the Santa Squad, that would be really fun.
Like if they had lots of people in this squad who were doing things, and then that's when you have sequels for a movie, because every one of them could have their own, the whole series.
Yeah. I mean, if this was the X-Men of Christmas movies, I would be super excited.
That would have been fun.
It doesn't appear to be the case. But I'm going to give it a sock. But what do you think, Dory?
I'm also going to give it an orange because I like the widower movies. What can I say? Yeah. And this also sounds a little bit to me about, I also love the personal shopper movies where they have to come like really get to know the guy so that they can figure out what his gift giving, you know, style would be to all the people in his life. And I kind of get that vibe from this. So I think it has some potential, but it does sound super basic. You know, we've seen this in a lot of different ways, but I have a feeling I might like it. It has potential.
All right. Okay. So then we have In Love by Christmas. And we'd like to take a second to thank our sponsors for this episode of the podcast. They are the good folks over at Care Of. And they've been a sponsor for us for quite a little while. And we're very grateful to them. And they have high quality products, meets personalization. And I think that's what makes them special. And all of Care Of's products are formulated with good for you, clean ingredients that are backed by science. And they are super transparent about the research and sourcing behind all of their products, and you get individualized recommendations that come in daily individual wrapped packets that are perfect for getting back into a routine. We all are sort of struggling with that right now, and you have, even it has your name on it. They're very individualized, and the way that they become individualized is they start you off with you taking their 5-minute online quiz. And this quiz, it asks you about your lifestyle, your sort of your belief in vitamins, how you feel about that, your lifestyle, your skepticism, your health concerns, all that stuff are taken into effect. And then you are given with your recommendations for what you should be taking. And that's very, very helpful. And you can adjust your pack at any time. It's like having a one-on-one consultation with a nutritionist, all without leaving your house. And I know when I took the quiz, I was able to narrow down to my sleep needs as being my highest priority. So I was able to get some of the Dream Team on the go quick sticks, and those have melatonin as well as other
properties that are good for helping you to sleep, and they've been great. It's a wonderful service that they offer and makes things quick and easy. You can have it delivered, you can have it on a regular basis, or you can individually order your vitamins. Important for all of us right now with fall coming on that we fall back into a healthy routine. As the season changes, it's important to get ahead of taking care of your immune health. It takes about 30 days for your body to adapt to new nutrients. So now is a great time to update your vitamin and wellness routines to help support your immune system this fall. Caravage products go beyond vitamins and supplements to include protein powders and boosts to help supplement your workouts as you move indoors in the colder months. So you will really find it helpful. For 50% off your first Caravage order, go to takecareof.com, enter code HallmarkIs50. That's new code. So go to takecareof.com, enter code HallmarkIs50. It'll be great for you. You'll really love it. And thanks so much.
Mandy Leeds, a successful young woman living in Miami, is climbing her way up the corporate ladder in the hotel industry. Though she doesn't get back to her small northern hometown much, this year her Graham is able to finally convince her to come home for Christmas. Mandy has another reason too. The quaint local inn is for sale and she wants to acquire it for her company. With her eyes on the prize, Mandy travels back home, but on her way there, she runs into Lucas Manzino, her high school rival, who has his eye on the inn as well. And I would say that the main appeal to this for me is Jesse Hedge, because I really do like him, and I think he's usually funny, and I think he elevates any movie that he's in, makes it better. I can't think of a movie that he's in that has been awful. So that's the main, I mean, the plot doesn't do a whole lot for me. And so I don't know. What do you think, Rachel?
Again, I like him, but it's nothing. It didn't really stand out as like spectacular, but I'll watch it.
Yeah. What do you think, Dory? Do you agree?
I do agree. I'm going to give it a sock also. I'm not crazy about these, like corporation goes in the small town to buy up whatever. Mm-hmm. I think we actually see that a fair amount, and I'm not sure that it's ever really worked for me. But I do love Jesse Hutch, and I feel like we get him in small doses, so like I'm even more excited when I see him, you know. Like he's been in a lot of these movies, but there have been years, like years long stretches where we don't have him in anything.
They're spread out. Yeah,
exactly. Mm-hmm. They're spread out. So I'm very like into him, love him. I think that if this is good, it's going to be on the strength of his performance, because we love him.
I agree. And I mean, if you think about Let It Snow with Jesse Hutch, kind of similar plot.
Very similar
hotel and everything. Okay, so then we have the Christmas setup, and this is coming out on the next we have the Christmas setup, which is coming out on the 12th, and this stars Ben Lewis and Blake Lee, who are a real life married couple, which is exciting.
Aww.
Yes. And Fran Drescher. Hello. Oh. Yes. So excited.
Diamond. Sorry, just cancel it now.
Couldn't even get through the synopsis. Like everybody else is all like, ooh, diversity. And I'm like, yes, that's amazing. But Fran Drescher.
But this is the perfect movie for her to make her lifetime holiday appearance in. I'm all about everything about this movie, but Fran Drescher, that's going to be fun. Yeah. She's going to have a blast doing this.
Because a lot of people don't realize how progressive The Nanny actually was as a show.
Yeah,
like they have tons of LGBT representation in The Nanny. I mean, rare, because in the Francast that I host with my friends, rare an episode goes by that we're not talking about some kind of gay storyline or some other kind of representation. And of course, they didn't like think of it in that terms back then. But nevertheless, I mean, especially for the 90s, I mean, she was way ahead of her game there. And so she's, for her to be in the first of these major network gay yeah. Christmas movies is absolutely perfect and brilliant. And I'm so excited. I am absolutely a huge Fran Drescher fan. I've been wanting her to be in one of these movies so bad for so long. So thank you to the Lifetime people for answering my Christmas wishes. And but let's read the synopsis. Okay. The Christmas setup follows the story of New York lawyer Hugo, who heads to Milwaukee with his best friend Madeline to spend the holidays with his brother Aiden and his mom Kate, who is also in charge of the local Christmas celebrations. Ever the matchmaker, Kate arranges for Hugo to run into Patrick, Hugo's high school friend and secret crush, who has recently returned after a successful stint in Silicon Valley. As they enjoy the local holiday festivities together, Hugo and Patrick's attraction to each other is undeniable, and it looks as though Kate's Santa-style matchmaking is a success. But as Hugo receives word of a big promotion requiring a move to London, he must decide what is most important to him. So there's so much to be excited about of this, but just the idea alone of Fran Drescher being the busybody matchmaker, mm-hmm. diamond ring. I don't care who the couple is. Mm-hmm. I'm on board. But the fact that this is a real life married couple is very exciting. And one of the things that Amy Winter said in the interview is that, you know, when she first heard they wanted to do this, she was a little bit concerned that she doesn't want it to veer into after school special kind of territory mm-hmm. or anything like that. Being the first, there's sort of maybe a hesitancy to try to do that. And then she read the treatment and she just absolutely loved it. And she thought it was so sweet and fun and just a really cute story. So she totally sold me on it. Not that I needed to be sold. So diamond rings all the way on this. I think this is going to be great. And yay. This would be if I was doing an article on my top three Christmas movies, period, Hallmark and Lifetime, this would be make the cut for me in that. Do you agree, Dory?
Oh, for sure. This is my most anticipated Lifetime premiere of the holidays. Diamond rings, 10 diamond rings, one for every finger. I think this sounds so cute. Like you said, Fran Drescher was like made to play the busybody matchmaking mama. And the fact that it's a gay couple just takes it all the way over the top. I just can't wait to see this couple falling in love during the holidays. Like, we've literally never seen that before on one of mm-hmm. these movies. And that's a big deal. Mm-hmm. And I'm so ready. Like, we've been waiting for this moment and it's here. And I could not be more excited for this movie. I mean, I can't see a way that I don't like this movie. Yeah. You know, I can't see it.
I agree. Do you agree, Rachel?
And what I love is that with any of the films that we're talking about that are doing a wonderful, albeit somewhat late, we can all say, job at these major steps in diversity, none of them are quote unquote issue stories,
yeah.
which mm-hmm. is wonderful. As you said, the after school special. I mean, Fran Drescher is obviously, she's always been for inclusivity and positivity, but never in an after school on this very special episode of Blossom way. And I think that is the way to include diversity into these movies, is just to make people fall in love and be happy and represent everyone without it having to have some kind of obstacle or where we redirect the focus to some kind of issue. And I think that's why, that Canadian show Schitt's Creek has done so well. It's just, it's just a part of that. So, but
effortless.
A lot of diamonds for Fran Drescher, because I was not expecting that. So it's like, mm-hmm. boom, Fran Drescher, she's in this.
Yes.
And I mean, I love the Jewish woman who's like, yeah, I'll do a Christmas movie. Why not?
That's it's right. Great. Yes.
I love it.
I mean, on the nanny, there's a whole animated Christmas special episode.
Yes.
We just covered it on the show. This is very exciting.
I mean, and does the nanny not have the best opening credits of any show ever? Yes. Between the song and the animation. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, Queen Fran Drescher, welcome to the fold. I hope we have more holiday movies with her, because she is a goddess and we worship her.
Yeah. Agreed. All right. Very good. Okay. Then on the 13th of December, we have A Sugar and Spice Holiday. This stars Jackie Lay and Tony Garreau and Yi Ma, I believe. Sorry if I pronounce names wrong. And this one is directed by Jennifer Liao. And she has been so cute on Twitter.
She has
when they first announced it, I said, welcome to the Christmas movie making family. And she was like, I'm so excited. And so I'm delighted with her. And I hope we can get her on the podcast. I'm hoping so. But anyway, and then written by Irene Donahue, and Amy told me that it was very important for them to have the diversity both in front of and behind the camera in for a Lifetime with this, so it wasn't just that this is a Chinese American story, but that they had the director, the writer, everything like that. So that is really cool. And so the plot is, it follows Susie, a rising young architect who returns to her small hometown in Maine for Christmas, where her Chinese American parents, Pete and Mimi, run the local lobster bar. Following the loss of her beloved grandmother, who was a legendary baker in their community, Susie is guilted into following in her grandmother's footsteps by entering the local gingerbread house competition. Teaming up with an old high school friend, Billy, who grew up to be a catch, Susie must find the right recipes and mix of sugar and spice infused with her cultural traditions to win the competition and perhaps find some love in the process. And I have to say, if I just read the summary, I would think this is a Lacey Chabert movie. It sounds very LC to me. But I like the fact that this was not something that they just tagged on the Chinese American element to it. This was something that was brought to them by this writer, Irene Donahue, I believe, and sold to them. And they were, you know, excited about it. So that was the impression I got from what Amy said. And so that makes me excited about it. And I, you know, I'm just, again, more representation. I thought the director was really cute. So I'm going to give it an orange, and an orange with diamond dust. The plot seems pretty basic, but I really want to love it. So I hope I will. What do you think, Rachel?
I think that orange with dust, the gingerbread thing is overdone, but if they're going to interweave her family's heirlooms and traditions into gingerbread, then yeah, that would give it an interesting slant. Diamond dust for making sure that inclusivity and diversity are not just in front of the camera, but also behind, because that is something that a lot of us need to think about. It's not just the people on the camera. We need to be making sure that we're having diverse teams in every area of these films. But it sounds really cute, but gingerbread is overdone. But
yeah, what do you think, Dora?
I'm with both of you, the orange but with diamond dust sprinkled all over it, because I do think the gingerbread aspect is really overplayed. But I'm just reading a little bit about the writer Irene Donahue's background. And it says she's the youngest of seven children born to a Vietnamese mother and an American naval officer. She grew up in Rhode Island. After graduating from Brown University, spent years traveling and working around the world, teaching English in Japan, temping on Wall Street, and sailing in South Africa. So what I like about this is that I'm sure it draws from her real life experience. I love that she grew up on the East Coast. She's from Rhode Island. This takes place in Maine. So I think that it can feel authentic, because it sounds like so many pieces of her actual life are going to be placed into this movie. And that actually gives me a whole lot of hope for this one. So yeah, I'm gonna definitely stick with you guys. Orange with some diamond dust.
Yeah, because it's not like they had, you know, sugar and spice movie and our gingerbread movie and said, okay, how can we make it Chinese? That's not what happened here.
Yeah.
Right. It's organic to the story, and exactly. It's always mm-hmm. tell.
Yeah. Okay. Then we have Lone Star Christmas, and this one is on December 14th, and this stars Stephanie Bennett and Marco Grazzini, who we talked about earlier. And it's when a single mom, Erin, takes her daughters to spend Christmas with her estranged dad on his Texas ranch, she unexpectedly falls in love with local restaurateur Mateo while learning to forgive her father for the past. And so, yeah, I don't know. What do you think of this one, Rachel?
Sock, only because I think I just watched this when it was called something else with Treat Williams.
I'm Rocky Mountain Christmas.
Yeah, I feel the ranch thing and the restaurant. I mean, Sock, because it does seem a little bit tired, but I'm up for a hot restaurateur. Like, I'll watch it, but it just doesn't have the same pizzazz of some, like, is Fran Drescher in it?
Because that's going to be my new thing. Every movie,
I'll probably.
So Stephanie Bennett, she was in The Last Bridesmaid. She played the bride in that case, which I thought she was really cute, actually. Mm-hmm. And she was also in Valentine in the Vineyard. I think she married Marcus Rosner in that movie, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, I think so.
And then it's directed by Lucy Guest, who did Love on Harbor Island. She's been in a bunch of Hallmark movies as an actress, and now she's doing some acting, some directing. I didn't love Love on Harbor Island. It had some nice things about it, but I'm definitely willing to give her another shot. This is written by Allison Spuck McNeely. So I love the fact that it's all female, mm-hmm. Which is cool. She did Hearts of Winter, which I actually didn't love. I thought it was kind of a snooze, but I'm willing to give her another shot as well. I'm going to give this an orange. It doesn't, I don't know. I'm hoping that I'll like it. But it does seem kind of basic, but I don't know. I'd be probably more excited if her father was somebody like James Brolin or someone like that, that mm-hmm. I was a little more excited about. So, what do you give it, Dory?
I'm a little more optimistic. I'm going to give it an orange as well, but I'm a little more optimistic. This sounds to me like Lifetime does one of these every year, right? Like, there's mm-hmm. Christmas in Louisiana. There's yeah. Christmas in Mississippi. Mm-hmm. This sounds very similar, but now it's in Texas. And I'll tell you what, I love all of them. There has not been one, you know, Christmas
right
in blank Southern state with, blank you know, yeah. You know, like yeah. slot yeah. in your Southern state and there is yeah. a either single mom or hardworking business lady who is coming from the big city back to her hometown, and they have all worked for me. And so based on that history, I'm in.
Mm. Mm. All right. I can see that. Rachel, what did you give?
Yeah, I was a sock. And I'm going to keep my sock, but my sock can always turn to an orange. That's the magic of Christmas.
Good. Very good. That's right. Okay. So then we have Christmas on the Menu, and this is December 18th. And this stars Kim Shaw, Clayton James, and Cynthia Gibb. And this is also written and directed by Jake Helgren, who we talked about earlier. So Kim Shaw, she was in Christmas Scavenger Hunt last year, which I feel okay. like I liked more than almost anybody else. And Dory was actually on the podcast that we recapped it. Mm-hmm. And we laughed so hard, even just her food choices. We were laughing.
Yeah, wasn't it chili and a strawberry milkshake or something? And we were both like, you'd be sick. You'd be out of the Christmas scavenger hunt because you'd be in the bathroom. Yeah. Like, that's crazy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And she's like they were making cookies. And I loved in that movie, the other guy in that movie, he played by John Welch. I forget his I loved, we interviewed him and I absolutely loved that interview. And I love Kevin McGarry. So that one I liked more than most people seem to have enjoyed.
There was, as I recall, there was a lot going on in that movie.
Yeah.
Like, wasn't there, a part with a veteran, like a veteran comes home at a certain
and Tom point. Arnold was in it.
Yeah. Yeah. There's Logan. So, and you're just right. You're just like, wait, now what's happening? And they kept getting those texts. Oh yeah. Man.
And the but other, the other
because of the graphic on the bottom of the Hallmark screen. Oh man. I had lots of complaints about this.
The other guy, Logan, they just leave him at the airport with nobody to pick him up. And he's like, didn't you get my message? She's like, no, sorry. I'm like, that's nope. The ultimate insult to leave.
I was scavenger hunting. Sorry.
Scavenger hunt. So that's exciting.
For Rachel, that is exciting.
Yeah, for me. I loved that movie, and I think that's so funny. Okay, here we go. Next, here's the description. Josie Jennings, a celebrated romantic 35-year-old chef in the city, heads home to spend the holidays at the quaint magical bed and breakfast where she grew up. And her mother, Shannon, has just opened a new restaurant. Famous food critic Tanner Rhodes, who has given Josie harsh reviews in the past, comes to town to review the new restaurant and Josie's Christmas cuisine. As the holidays unfold, Josie and Tanner get to know each other better and a romance soon begins to blossom. But will Tanner find a way to right his wrongs, write a rave review for the bistro's delicious cuisine, and win Josie's heart by Christmas Eve? Who knows what's going to happen? So I do like a movie with a critic. As a film critic myself, I'm a fan of that. Falling in Love, I think that's great. I think it's cool to have Cynthia Gibb in a Lifetime movie. I think that's cool. And I have to also say about the interview with John Welsh, you should totally listen to it because he talks all about how the hotel that they were staying at was haunted.
Oh, wow.
During the movie. And oh it's the, I love that interview so much. You should check it out. It's one of my favorites. But so yeah, this one sounds fun to me. I'm going to give it, I don't know if I'm quite a diamond ring level, but I will give it a dusted orange, a diamond dusted orange. I hope I like it. Please like it. What do you think, Rachel?
I think half sock, half orange, because yeah. I do like the idea of the restaurant critic, but this isn't just a story we've seen in another year. Like, I feel like we've heard this story in tonight's recap. Like, yeah. It's with the restaurant just opening before Christmas. I think we're getting a few of these this year. So it should be like its own subgenre. I do like the idea of a restaurant critic, but I also think that there are a lot of restaurant movies. But I got to give it to, as soon as I heard Christmas on the Menu, I knew what this movie was about.
Yeah.
I just figured it out.
Yeah.
Half sock, yeah. Half orange.
Probably won't live up to the glory of Christmas Scavenger Hunt. But we can hope. And Dory, do you agree?
The glory.
The glory. Oh, boy. Yeah. I have to give this a sock. What is her Christmas cuisine? Josie's Christmas cuisine.
Gingerbread house.
Exactly. Yeah. Is that a gingerbread house? Is that Christmas cookies? Is that, I don't know.
A lot of cranberries, like a turkey.
Probably. Yeah. No. I don't know. Like Rachel just said, I feel like we have heard this description tonight already. And I am not excited for this. But you know what? I live to be surprised. And, you know, there's always some random movie that everyone hates that I like. Maybe this yes. will be it. You know?
Yeah.
I'm obviously going to watch this. And I might even love it. But from the description alone, I can't give it
yeah.
more for a diamond. I'm sorry.
All right. So then we have, we're almost done. So then we have A Christmas Exchange And this is, that's just a working title. This is on December 19th. And this stars Lara Vandervoot and Raymond Soon Franks. Name. And the summary is, and this is directed by Justin Dyke, who we've had on our podcast. And he did A Very Country Christmas, which I actually really enjoyed.
Oh, I liked both of
those. Yeah, both of those for Up. Christmas in Paris, which I liked last year, and the Christmas with a Prince movies, both of those he did. Wow. Which I also liked, which had Charles Shaughnessy in it from The Nanny.
Yes.
So yeah, we're getting there. Okay, and then this is written by Niall Kimmel, who did Love Alaska, which is, I think, very underrated and was quite good. It's definitely a tearjerker, but that also stars Victor Zink Jr. Very good, that I liked. And I was thinking about maybe doing that for On Friendship coming up next year. So anyway, but I liked that. So that's good writer. Okay, so the holiday season has started and Molly Cooper is looking for joy. Finally living her childhood dream, Molly swaps her quaint farmhouse for London financier Patrick Kingston's posh apartment. Through the ups and downs of her new life in London and searching for romance, Molly begins to look forward to all communication with Patrick. Likewise, Patrick finds Molly's warm emails and texts charming and compelling. Sparks fly between them as they get to know each other as they live in each other's spaces. It's a little house swap going on here.
Hello, Trading Christmas. Let's do you again.
Get ready to see Vancouver as London.
Get ready to see that same. Oh, when Vancouver's Boston, it just makes me laugh. It's like you see the overhead and then it's like, hello, Vancouver. We're not even trying anymore. We tried for the credits.
I think it actually sounds kind of cute, to be honest.
It does.
So I'm going to give this just a regular old orange. No dust, but I think it sounds like it could be cute to me. I don't know either of these actors. That's my only real hesitancy on it. But do you agree, Dory?
I'm giving it a diamond. Oh. This is my catnip. A house exchange movie. Pen pals. I mean, this
one
this
side is, of Vancouver, the other side of
exactly. You know, I mean, I just can't think of a house swap movie that hasn't worked for me. I love The Holiday. Trading Christmas is my number one made for TV Christmas movie of all time.
The best.
It's excellent, and I know it can't be topped. But to even get like a little taste of that, diamond.
Do you agree, Rachel?
I am. Yeah, especially because we haven't seen a house swap in several seasons. Like, it's been a while since we've had that trope. And so I think a lot of people, Trading Christmas is now in Hallmark years, which are like dog years, many years. So there's a lot of new viewers who have not seen it.
Yeah. Yeah, if you haven't seen it, it's really good.
Watch that. Christmas. I definitely... I think that this has some major catnip going on. And we haven't seen this trope in a while, so it's time for another one.
Agree.
Yeah, I think so. The closest I can think of was like something like Christmas Getaway, but it was more like sharing the same cabin in that case.
Yeah.
And I loved that movie too. This is right up my alley.
Your jam.
This is my jam. I'm ready.
All right. So we have this is our final one. This is on the 20th, A Christmas Break. And this stars Cindy Sampson and Steve Byers. And Steve Byers was in The Christmas Cure. He was on Good Witch. So he's some... And the synopsis, school teacher Addison Tate wants this Christmas to be special for her kids, especially since the school board has decided that it will be the last as the school will be closing. When for Addison... COVID. Meets Danny, a Hollywood actor home to reconnect with his roots on a Christmas tree lot. Sparks fly, uniting the two to save the school from closing right before Christmas Eve. Yeah, and they're close because of COVID. Rachel, what do you think?
Nothing about this is just screaming yay, sock.
Yeah. Do you agree, Dory?
Yeah, this is sock for me with like the toe dipped in coal dust.
Yeah,
I think that's good. This does not excite me in any way.
Why line up people? Is this your December 20th film?
Right, that's what I was wondering.
This is your Halloween Eve film. You put Dresher on the 20th. Come on, people.
The only thing I can figure is she did tell me, Amy Winter said, that they only have 2 movies left. They're all the rest done, which is amazing. But maybe it's not finished. Maybe.
Oh, that makes sense.
That's my only guess. But yeah, I don't know this actress at all. It doesn't mean she's not awesome. But not enough to make me excited for the preview. So yeah, I think I'd go coal on it. It looks pretty basic. But there we go. That's it. We did it.
That's like a million movies, and 70% of them are set in restaurants.
or inns, bed and breakfast.
It's either restaurants or fighting for real estate property.
Yeah. It's going to be an interesting season, because who doesn't want to land their hot real estate property the week of Christmas?
Yeah.
Who doesn't want to move into an abandoned building over Christmas, you know?
Yeah. That's a good. I'm ready. So why don't we do a hashtag? So since this podcast is so long, listened to the entire podcast, you will, how about we love Lifetime. I'm trying to think of one that's not too long. Hashtag holiday Fran fans. How about that?
Ooh, cute.
Nice.
So hashtag holiday Fran fans. Put that in your tweet or other social media post, Instagram, whatever, and we'll know that you listened to the entire long podcast, but hopefully you enjoyed it. We sure do enjoy doing these previews, and there's a lot to look forward to. We gave out a lot of diamond rings. We really did.
Yeah. We did.
Very few coal, very few. And so we will have information for Rachel for your book in the Woo-hoo! Description. Make sure y'all check it out. It's super cute. We're really excited. Thank you so much for joining us. This is
It was a hoot. Thank you. I'm going to be tweeting with both of you when we watch all of these.
Yes.
Because, man, I'm looking forward to about 80 zillion hours of Christmas movies.
Yeah. It's going to be.
I'm so ready.
It's so epic.
It's going to be more this year. It's going to be extra sweet. Right. Dory, how can people find you?
You can find me at All the Feels Pod on Twitter.
Oh, that's you.
That's me.
Hi.
Yeah, that's me. So listen to our podcast, subscribe, talk to me on Twitter. We're also on Facebook, All the Feels Pod. And thank you for having me on, Rachel. It's always the best. And please, for some of these real estate movies, maybe have me and Rachel back on. So we can reevaluate how we felt about them.
How we felt about hero Chad Everest, who decides that now is the time to open a year-round Christmas store next to the other year-round Christmas store.
Yes.
Stay tuned, everybody. So suspenseful.
So And Rachel, what about you? What's your social media?
I'm everywhere on social media. I'm at Rach K Mick, R-A-C-H-K-M-C. So that's Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all R-A-C-H-K-M-C. And you can find me. I've written a bazillion books, but this one is specific to made-for-TV Christmas movies. And I love talking about them. So please find me.
Great. Yeah, we'll have all that in the description section. Make sure you follow that. And make sure that you're following the podcast, the Hallmarkies Pod and Hallmarkies Podcast, all over social media. And please leave your ratings and reviews if you're listening on iTunes. Really need that, especially going into this Christmas season. The more reviews we have, the more likely people will be able to find us and find the podcast. So please, 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 please do that. And if you are watching on YouTube, please give us thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. We appreciate that as well. And then we also have our Patreon group, which again, we are doing a watch along with Carly Smale, writer extraordinaire for Christmas Pen Pals, coming up this month. We have lots of other fun perks to being a patron, and we sure appreciate that. We also have our merch store, which has tons of festive designs, including our adorable elf shirts designed by artist Jessica Miller. So you